Welcome back to Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we have the great pleasure of speaking with André Aciman.
So, that book started your journey.
Yes, it did. It did. I knew at that point that, and I had such amazing reviews that I remember telling my wife that if my career took a downturn in anything, in academia, as a writer, I had reached exactly the point that I had longed for. That basically, if I died that day, I would have been a happy man because of the success of the book. Mm. And it's very nice to know that not only are any reader responding to your book, but everybody who came from Egypt wrote to me and basically saying, you wrote our life, because there was no memoir of anybody from Egypt at the time. So this was a totally new thing, and everybody read it, and it was wonderful. It was, and I never expected to have that kind of success ever again.
Did your wife expect that?
It's a good question. She was supportive. She was extremely, she took risks, because basically when she married me, I was just, I was an adjunct. I was not even fully employed at Princeton at the time. So I was an adjunct, and I was kept saying that I wanted to be a writer, and she believed it. I would never have believed it, and I was surprised that she did, but she did believe it, and she supported me throughout the whole thing, and it was amazing. It was an act of loyalty, of generosity.
Trust.
Of trust. Well, confidence in her husband.
Sure.
I had no confidence. I mean, I was writing, but I figured nobody's going to publish this.
After that huge success, did it make you just want to jump into the next project, or did you just say, let's just wait a while?
No, actually, it was a bit, I think a year late. For a while, I was giving a lot of talks, many, many talks, about having written out of Egypt and about adjacent subjects to writing the book on Egypt. And I published a lot of articles on that. So it kept me busy for a year. And after a while, I said, all these talks, they have some substance. I should publish them. And so eventually, I began to put together a manuscript of these talks. And they came out eventually, about 3 years later, in a book called False Papers. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, I had already started a new novel. And it was about a man and a woman who meet at a party. And the book goes on for about 8 nights. They meet every single night at a movie festival. And they don't have sex. Mm. For some reason, I wanted them to simply percolate in the romance of what it is that they were experiencing. And but it became a very difficult book to write. I got a contract right away for it, because people thought, okay, this is going to be good. I thought it was going to be good, but after the second night, I just couldn't. There were 8 nights, and the second night, I said, this is becoming too difficult. It was too challenging.
You mean emotionally?
No, just the actual writing of it. Mm. I didn't know where to go with it, because the normal thing would have been to have them have sex. Mm-hmm. But that was not the story, because then they were...
Then it's over.
Yes, it is over. There's nothing there to do.
You have 8 days to go.
Yeah, and but I wanted, and sometimes it's happened to me where you meet somebody who's wonderful and you want to find out, and you say, we don't have to sleep together, because that changes the formula. And so I wanted it to last, but I was having a hard time writing this book. And about 2 years into it, and I had changed jobs quite a few times already, from Bard to the Graduate Center, and doing all the things that you need to do to accommodate a change in venue, I decided I'm going to put this away for a while. Mm. Or at least I started writing another book. And I started it because we were going to go to Italy that year, and I was anticipating going to Italy and longing to go to Italy. We had this habit of renting a house for a few weeks in Italy every summer, which worked very well. And so eventually I started a book about being in Italy, a house in Italy. I didn't know where I was going. I was just having fun. I'm just writing something different. And then eventually it became Call Me By Your Name.
How did that name come about?
Well, we went through a series of possible titles.
Uh-huh.
And eventually I said, I think this is the one that I like. but I'm not sure it's going to work.
It's a wonderful name.
Well, it is, but if you think about it, when you come up with a title like this, it's unusual. And it's so unusual that I figured it's not going to work. And as soon as I proposed it, I got an email right back. Yes, this is it. We're going with this. Then we had choice of what cover to have. And I said no to all the covers. And they said, well, okay, that's it. You don't have a choice anymore.
The one at the swimming pool is the one that won out, the cover.
There's,
is that right?
No, there's a cover. Oh, well, there's
that's in
head.
There's a head.
Yes, but
different country have a different.
Yes. England has a swimming pool, I think, and different countries have different kind of things. The Italians have a sort of a caricature of a guy sort of jumping in a swimming pool.
Uh-huh. So just recently, the book has been made into a movie.
Yes, and I saw the movie I think 3 times already.
Hmm.
And I love it. And I think my kids saw it, and they loved it. And
what did they say?
They loved it. It's a beautiful film. It's a wonderful story. They loved it. And I don't. My kids are very critical. They said, "Dad, this piece that you published, why did you?"
Mm.
That sort of thing. So they're very frank.
Mm-hmm. Are they teenagers or
no? They're 20s.
Mid 20s.
So they're more or less adults. I treat them like kids, but they're.
Are they into the same area?
One of them is a writer. I have 3 boys, uh-huh. And one of them is a writer, mm-hmm. And he writes quite a lot and sort of pieces all over the place. The others are not into writing, although they do write a lot because one of them has a job as a PR person.
Oh, okay.
So he's always writing, and the other one is back in school getting an MBA.
Now, when the idea for the movie came out, the first question would be, who would write the script?
I didn't want to write the script, not because I didn't want to, but because I knew better. I didn't know how to write a script. Funnily enough, the 2 best scenes in the film, aside from the final one, which is absolutely gorgeous, which I couldn't have imagined, and it's beyond the competence of a writer to come up with that scene. But the other 2 scenes, I basically were taken verbatim out of the book.
Mm-hmm.
But the rest, I don't know how to write a script. I don't know how to do that. I've never been trained that way.
It's a very different way of.
I'm sure it is. And there are professionals who do it. And I have no sense of how it's done. So I didn't want to do it. So they had a screenwriter, they had a playwright trying the first, and he was very good, but he got another job. They all get other jobs while they're doing this if you wait too long. And so he had to go. Then we found another one, and then he had to go. And eventually we found James Ivory, whose script is the one behind the movie.
Did you have any say to the leading characters?
No, I didn't even know who they were. I mean, I had seen both of them, but I had no, because I don't go to the movies that much. I don't see movies. So I didn't know exactly who these characters were. But I figured the casting person knows. They're not going to cast somebody who's wrong for the part. So I figured I'll have to trust them. And they were wonderful.
Yeah.
Both of them turned out to be fantastic. The kid, Chalamet, is a brilliant natural actor, and he's only 21 years old.
Mm.
And Armie Hammer, whose roles have been usually sort of very sort of staid and typical, is amazing. He's moving, actually. Mm. You watch him, you watch his face as it changes expression from sort of concerned to really troubled, and it's there.
Mm.
I can't imagine the emotions you must go through as you sit there and watch your book on the screen.
You know, it's really weird because I know what you're saying, that I must be feeling something, sort of a form of sort of ebullience or whatever
right.
It is. Actually, I'm watching a movie.
Mm. Yeah.
And I know the ending because I've been told what the ending
right.
is. And I've also written the ending, but it's a different ending, but it's the same thing. And I'm always curious to the first time I saw it, I was curious to know what other scenes that they actually chose. And I think they made the right decision every single time. And
did they ask you to change a certain?
No, I wouldn't have done that. Mm. I mean, they stayed, everything was so on script, as it were. It was perfect. I felt it's not a question, did they do justice to my book? They created a beautiful movie. Mm-hmm. And all you have to do, which is amazing, today I got a press review of all the pieces that came out in England. Mm-hmm. And they're amazing. There's just nothing negative ever.
Wow.
And it's all praise. And after Sundance here in this country, the reviews were, I mean, people were crying mm-hmm. everywhere. It was very moving.
So you are very lucky. I mean, you know, as far as your editor and your, you know, this movie. And I think must be something has to do with you. You are just very generous, willing to let it go.
You have to. Yeah. You have to. I mean, I don't do that with my kids. I don't want them to move too far away. But I think with a work of fiction, once you've had your say, it's out of your hands. And now it's in the reviewer's hand, and you hope they do their job. And you have to. Otherwise, you become fastidious, which is not a good thing. And I tend to think I'm always wrong whenever there's a conversation or a confrontation. I always assume I'm wrong. So when an editor says, why don't you remove your brother? Or when they say, why don't you cut this? Why don't you move this? This is too much, somebody said. Because in a particular moment, there was too much sex. And he said, there's too much sex. Yeah, just tone it down. Okay, fine. I figure that these people know that. They know their craft. Just as I know mine, they know their craft. And when a film person decides to have Armie Hammer and Chalamet as the actors, and I had never seen Michael Stuhlbarg. I had never seen him. And I think if everything goes well, he should get an Oscar for being the part that he plays. He plays the minor role. It's a minor role, but it's a supporting actor. And he plays the father. Mm. And he gives a speech that is so well done. And it's moving. He himself has tears in his eyes as he's delivering that speech. And I figured the people who cast all these people know what they're doing. And the director is a very competent director. Am I going to sort of argue with him? No.
Have you visited the set?
I was on the set. I was on the set, and I even played a part in the movie.
You did? Yeah.
And
he's all a Hitchcock somehow.
Yeah,
that's right.
Listen, it's no longer than a Hitchcock appearance. It's just a few seconds, but I'm there, and I loved it. I loved being on the set, and I arrived on the set at a scene that I had a great deal of trouble writing, and I arrived on the scene when they were actually playing it out, and they were doing it again and again and again and again, and so I was very happy to arrive at that sort of very sort of almost fateful moment.
So what's next?
Well,
you have a new book.
I have a new book that's come out in mm-hmm. February. It came out in February already. And there's already sort of minor talk on what to do with the first story in the book. Mm. Because it's very much like Call Me By Your Name. It takes place in Italy. It's about a 12-year-old boy who has a crush on a guy who's about 28 years old.
Mm.
And the difficult part is that the boy does not know. He doesn't know anything about sex. Mm-hmm. He doesn't even know how to masturbate, so mm-hmm. he doesn't know anything. Mm-hmm. And here he is very attracted to this man, and he thinks it's a friendship that he wants, but the reader and the author know far better than the kid does what's going on. Mm-hmm. But I can't have the kid know this. Mm. And it's a study on this. It's not it's sort of a sickly obsession, but it is an obsession. And I think that's what love is. When we're in love, we're obsessed. We have to be, otherwise we're not in love. And I think he is in love with the guy, and he doesn't understand it.
Being a musician, I have to ask what the connection with Elgar's Enigma Variations. Is there a connection? Obviously, there is.
Well, there is. In that particular story, the father and the son, basically, to exclude the mother in their relationship, they sing or they hum the Diabelli Variations. That's what they do. It's all about the Diabelli Variations are at the center of that story. But Enigma Variations came to me as a title because it is about not knowing who you are, what you want, whom you want, which way does your sexuality go, this way or that way or both, and what does that mean? And so they are all variations on a theme, as you know from Elgar, the theme is not ever given. Right. So you don't know what the theme that is being varied.
That's part of the enigma of the
Yeah,
whole.
That's right. So it basically, they're all variations on a missing theme. And I think ultimately we don't know who we are. And we keep sort of going through life with different partners, with variations in our lives. And we don't know what the fundamental core theme is. Some people are lucky because they find it.
Does the 12-year-old boy find it? Or can you give that away?
I don't think he does. I don't think he does. But then he's too smart to think that he's found it. He goes from various people. I mean, basically, he's in his 20s, then he's in his 30s and 40s, and then he's in his 50s. And you don't know his age, so you have to assume that he's changed. But it just moves, and he doesn't. There's no fixed point in his life.
Probably he just find his own way.
Well, maybe the variation is his way. And his girlfriend tells him, you know, what we have may never have existed, but it will never die. And she says, now you have to go back to your lover. You don't belong to me. Mm-hmm. And his lover is a man. And so she says, you should go back to him. He's the one you should be with. And he says, okay, fine, I'll go back to him.
Are you already working on a new one?
Yes, I am. And it's a difficult book because I'm writing it from the perspective of a first person, a third person, and then I'm swapping the sexes so that it's actually the third voice is going to be a woman going through the same story, but it's written from the point of view of a woman.
Mm-hmm. Complicated.
Very challenging. Mm-hmm. But I like... I don't come out as a experimental writer. I'm very conservative. My sentences are very conservative, but my subject matter is not conservative. And at the same time, I love to experiment with the genre itself, without necessarily making you sort of lose your mind and go crazy because you don't understand what's going on, which a lot of people do. And I hate when I don't understand, because then I think I'm stupid, and I've learned enough to know that I'm not the stupid person. The stupid person is the author.
You probably want to get lost in your confusion situation.
Sometimes. I don't mind getting lost, but I have to come out of it because mm-hmm. I don't like uncertainty. I mean, I don't mind ambivalence and ambiguity, but total uncertainty when it comes to the form itself is not a right thing. Art is not about... Art has to give you an arc. And if it doesn't give you an arc, it's actually cheating. And it could be an arc about somebody who's ambivalent, but the form cannot be uncertain.
Speaking of form, you teach young writers.
Yeah.
And I would assume that involves the technique of writing. Right. Now, being a musician, we have a technique as a pianist or a technique of singing. In a few words, what is a technique of writing?
Well, that's a complicated question. I think every author has his or her own technique. That's obvious. You have to understand how are you going to put together the information in a way that is absolutely conclusive. The information that you provide the reader has to be conclusive, not just to the reader, but to yourself. In other words, you've done your job. You've concretized this in one sentence. And you go, as a writer, I go sentence by sentence by sentence. Now, the one thing I've learned from Proust is that every sentence is really a story in and of itself. And it's like, you know, the Goldberg variations. You know, everything has its own sort of arc. And it's all, every sentence has a thing. It has a beginning, which is usually uncertain. It has a middle, which sometimes tries to gives it space. And then it has the closure, which is usually a surprise. And I think that every sentence has to do that. Now, you don't go writing into it, but you'd have to know that this end of the sentence has to be conclusive. and it has to be surprising. In fact, it has to, what I call sort of the frontal tap. You say, why didn't I think of that, says the reader. I should have seen this coming. You need to surprise those. So when you have that, then you begin to have something called voice. Because and you have to have it in a calibrated manner so that it is there all the time, as opposed to just sometimes.
You probably can't really teach. You probably use different words for that, right? To teach somebody to write.
I don't think you can teach somebody to write, but you can certainly alert them to what it is that they need to do if they want to write. In other words, you hope that your voice gets into their psyche deep down so that they know that something like, André would basically like this if I did it this way. Now, they don't have to satisfy me, but they have to understand that there's some kind of standard. Not every sentence is okay. Not every story is okay. Not everything is okay. You have to have a kind of a certain rhythm. It has to have harmony. And you always, always have to have order. Because without order, there's nothing can be luminous if it's not well built.
How do you tell a person you can be a writer or you cannot be a writer?
You don't want to say that.
I know.
Well, I have a lot of, I've had some students who are Holocaust survivors, and they want to write a story about their suffering and to sort of pass it on to their grandchildren, which I think is a noble thing to do. You writing your life because you went through something that's so horrible that it's indelible. You don't want to erase it. You don't want it lost. And you want your grandchildren to know it. And so they write their story. And moving as the experience itself is that they are narrating, it can be very bad writing. In other words, it doesn't have tempo. It doesn't have suspense. It doesn't have all those things that makes a good joke teller at a bar, a person you want to hear. Have you ever said to somebody, tell me that joke again? I loved it because you said it so beautifully. Just tell me the joke again. I want to hear it. And I'll laugh again. In other words, the person knows how to deliver a story, a joke, with the punchline coming at the very right time. If you don't do that, then your story, however moving it is, it's not going to work. It's not going to interest the reader. It's not going to keep the reader. It's not going to give the reader something they don't already know. And there's no way you can tell somebody how to do it. You just have to tell them, you have to disassemble the whole thing without hurting their feelings, which is difficult to do.
It sounds to me like the process is slow. Do you consider yourself a...
Well, it depends. It depends on what it is that you're doing. If you're hot and you feel sort of carried away by what you're writing, it can take no time at all. I mean, I wrote Call Me By Your Name, and it's a known fact, in 3 months.
Ah. Mm.
Very fast, because it just flew out of the pen. I was in love with them. I was in love with the Italy. I was in love with the whole, I was in love with their love, the whole thing. I mean, basically, I was as stirred up as they were. Mm-hmm. But then the book, the other one, the one about the 8 white knights, that basically was difficult to write. And I finished it. I was happy with the result. It's my favorite book. But I don't think anybody really fell in love with it because it's a difficult, torturous book.
Why is it your favorite?
Because it has more of me in it than any other book I've written. Mm. My hesitations vis-a-vis, my uncertainties, my fantasies, my fears, my ambivalence, all these things are spelled out in big time.
How did you overcome the difficulty?
Just I was lucky enough because I was... I took the manuscript with me. I went to Yaddo, which is a writing retreat. And there you do nothing but write. And there was no internet. So in those days, there were no internet. And I just sat and wrote all day long. And I said, I'm going to have to do this. It was an effort to write it. And eventually, I fell in love with the chapter. And by the time I had finished chapter 3 and was starting chapter 4, I felt, okay, the juices are flowing. I know what I'm doing. And it worked.
It worked. Unfortunately, we must stop, but it's been absolutely fascinating. We could go on a long time, but thank you so much for coming
and sharing.
Thank you for
having me. Thank you. Thank you.
This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis today. We've had great pleasure in speaking with André Aciman.